Hi.
Hello.
Morning. Can we pull up the slides po? Yeah. Okay, so good morning to everyone. So the Department of Health is supporting and coordinating with the Department of Education to build confidence for face-to-face schooling. Next slide, please. So first, we need to update the protection from COVID-19 through facilitating vaccination. The threat of COVID and its variants is still there. No? People can still get infected and infect others. This is why we aim to bring vaccination closer to everyone, no? Including our teachers, learners, and parents through our settings-based strategy. And this includes our communities, our schools, our places of work, and places of worship, among others. But it's not just COVID-19 that we need to be wary of, no? We also recommend to update routine immunization for the school community to be protected against other infectious diseases and not just COVID-19. These vaccines are already being used since before the pandemic and have been proven safe and effective with decades of experience. Lastly, our collaboration with regional offices, provincial offices, and local governments for vaccination events and launches to raise awareness, no, and risk perception for COVID-19. Second, next slide, is to ensure school safety through the continued practice of the minimum public health standards. Vaccines alone or the MPHS alone cannot be the solution for our protection. They must be done together. So the department has continued coordination to provide inputs to our operational guidelines for face-to-face learning, no? So since the pilot and the expansion. This includes ensuring adequate ventilation and the continued wearing of face masks according to the local context. So depending on the available space, the flexibility is provided by the level of risk. And we also provide our visual cues and materials to nudge the practice of our minimum public health standards. Next slide. This is what we need to build our champions for healthy behaviors. So our materials have been provided to advocate for both vaccination and the minimum public health standards through several avenues, no? Teacher or school-led targeted discussions with select families, the engagement of parent groups and parent-teacher associations. We see the importance of behavior modeling in school as done by our teachers to the learners, and this should be continued at home. This is why we want to target our parents in the school community. So our Be the Kid campaign materials, which you've heard earlier, you know, it focuses on students and learners, while our Pinas Lakas campaign focuses on our teachers, parents, and other staff that are returning to work. Lastly, on a more medium term intervention, we aim to ensure our children are healthy in healthy learning institutions. So earlier this year, the Department of Health issued our guidelines on the healthy settings framework for learning institutions with several education government agencies, including the Department of Education. Together with the DepEd, we started the pilot of this HLI framework in 9 LGUs and 273 last mile elementary schools starting June. These include health promotion services targeted for vaccination, mental health, and sexual and reproductive health. So we will continue our coordination to streamline the HLI governance structure and monitor the pilot for expansion to our remaining last mile elementary school. Thank you.
Thank you.
Atin pong napanood ang presentation mula po sa Department of Health. Ngayon naman po ay susundan po ito ng presentation mula po sa Department of Social Welfare and Development, DSWD, to be led by Ms. Mary Grace G. Flores, Nutritionist and Dietitian 3 from the Program Management Bureau.
Hello po. Good morning, everyone. So for the DSWD, can we have the slides, please? While the DSWD is continuously providing social services to all the vulnerable groups in our country, so the contribution of the DSWD to the 2022 Oplan Balik Eskwela, while waiting for the ECCD advisory, next slide, please. So the ECCD advisory is the Early Childhood Care and Development Council, who is providing guidance on the implementation of the child development center sessions and supervised neighborhood play groups. So at this point, since we are preparing for the opening of the classes for the children below 5 years old, the DSWD is conducting social preparations for the conduct of the supplementary feeding program. So next slide, please. Which is the provision of food in addition to the regular meals to currently enrolled children in child development centers or CDC and supervised neighborhood play group. And this is part of the DSWD's contribution to the ECCD program of the government. And currently, the program is on its 12th year of implementation. So we call it 12 cycle. So this is implemented nationwide on all the 17 regions in the Philippines, including our brothers and sisters in Bangsamoro and Autonomous Region of Muslim Mindanao. The social preparation being conducted at this point are the simultaneously signing of the Memorandum of Agreement and the Memorandum of Understanding to our implementing local government units, of course, with the help of our DILG. And at this point, we are also finalizing the master list of the enrollees, since our children are those below 5 years old, and the range of the age is 2 to 5 years old. And currently, the procurement of the hot meals is being conducted, as well as the procurement of our fresh milk, which is being conducted with the help of our National Dairy Authority and our partner, the Philippine Carabao Center. So this is also being conducted in all areas in the Philippines in the 17 regions nationwide. And the orientation of the program is also being implemented simultaneously with the help of our social worker in the local government unit and our child development center. So we are expecting, just like last year, the session for the ECCD commenced on September. So while waiting for the ECCD council's advisory, these are the social preparations being conducted by the department. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po, Ms. Mary Grace G. Flores. Sunod naman po ay ang ating partner agencies para sa pagpapatupad ng peace and order. Kasama po natin dyan ang ating Philippine National Police or PNP, Police Brigadier General Arnel Amor Libed, Deputy Director of the Police Community Relations.
Good morning, sir. Allow me to remove my mask, sir. To Yusek Pimaco Densing the Third, sir, and Yusek Rabis Cobedo, good morning, sirs, and to all fellow stakeholders and partner agencies of DepEd and members of the media, good morning. So on behalf of the Chief Philippine National Police, Police Brigadier, Police General Rodolfo Santos Azurin Jr., your Philippine National Police will ensure the peace and order, public safety, and security of our students, teachers, and the general public during the opening of classes this August 2022 nationwide, and the whole duration of classes this school year 2022. With the current peace and order security framework of the PNP being implemented, the M plus K plus K equals K order, or the malasakit, kaayusan, at kapayapaan tungo sa kaunlaran, your Philippine National Police, in coordination with the DepEd, the LGUs and other stakeholders will intensify coordination, collaboration, and law enforcement activities towards a safer environment for our students. May I request everyone to focus your attention on our ABP to highlight your PNP's effort and initiatives for the Ligtas Balik Eskwela 2022. Please play the ABP. Thank you.
To ensure peace and order and public safety during the opening of school classes nationwide, the Philippine National Police intensify the law enforcement activities at learning institutions, transportation hubs, and places of convergence to prevent and suppress the occurrence of crime incidents wherein students, teachers, and parents and guardians are vulnerable to different crimes. The PNP will mobilize non-government organizations, NGOs, and civilian voluntary organizations, CVOs, to assist in the opening of classes in providing security, traffic assistance, and other related public safety services in coordination with local government units and the Department of Education. The participation of PNP personnel in Brigada Eskwela programs nationwide for the preparation for the opening of classes will ensure Ligtas Balik Eskwela, PNP program for the school year 2022 to 2023. The following initiatives and preparations of the PNP for the opening of classes nationwide. PNP Police Assistance Desk, PADS. The PNP provides PADS nationwide with detailed personnel to public and private schools to ensure peace and order for the whole learning period of the students and smooth conduct of affairs by the school management. PNP Advocacy in Schools, the Bisita Eskwela I Am Strong was started in 2018 in partnership with Jamie V. Ongman Foundation, which is also conducted through virtual Bisita Eskwela dubbed as Project Vibes. This is information education conducted in public and private schools nationwide participated by pupils for the protection of children against abuse, exploitation, and discrimination that may be committed by any person. Some laws that have been part of information education were the RA 9262 Anti-Violence Against Women and Their Children Act of 2004, the RA 10627 Anti-Bullying Act of 2013, the RA 10364 Expanded Anti-Trafficking in Persons Act of 2012, and the RA 9344 Juvenile Justice and Welfare Act of 2006. In addition to this program, there are donations of hygiene kits for protection of pupils and to adhere to current health protocol. This project conducted 113,811 activities and 5,788,188 pupils benefited from this project. The PNP Project Ready, known as Resistance Education Against Drugs for the Youth, is a preventive information and education program to protect the youths who are the most vulnerable to drug abuse. The primary objective of the program is to educate the youths on the harmful effects of dangerous drugs and also to instill leadership values and sense of social responsibility. This information and education program is cost-effective and responsive to local setting targeting elementary and high school pupils and out-of-school youths in the community. The PNP Ligtas Balik Eskwela 2022, this is in coordination, collaboration, and partnership with the school teachers, civilian volunteer organizations, parents, students, and other stakeholders participated in the activities in support to the Brigada Eskwela of the Department of Education nationwide. In the National Capital Region, the five police districts of NCRPO spearhead the Ligtas Balik Eskwela program at their respective area of responsibility. PNP Information Drive, using television, radio, internet, messaging, and print work, shrimp, in informing the parents, guardians, pupils, and students about the safety tips and anti-crime for the opening of classes since year 2022 to 2023. The PNP is organizing the NGOs, CVOs, and civic or volunteer groups to assist in providing security, traffic assistance, and other related public safety services in coordination with local government units, LGUs, and DepEd. The Philippine National Police mandate is to serve and protect the people and will ensure the Ligtas Balik Eskwela 2022.
Thank you, sir. That's all for the Philippine National Police, sir.
Maraming salamat po mula po sa Philippine National Police. Atin pong napanood ang kanilang paghahanda para po sa darating na balik eskwela. Ngayon po, pakinggan naman natin ang ating partners para sa pagsisiguro ng kaligtasan sa ating pagbabalik eskwela. Narito po ang Department of Public Works and Highways, DPWH, to be led by Engineer Ray Del Rosario, our chief from the Maintenance Division.
Ako na po ang magpipresent, si Asik Jun Mulano. Okay, so the DPWH is participating regularly in the annual Balik Eskwela program for school year 2022 to 2023. Next slide. This is an offshoot of the letter of USEC Sibilia when we learned that there will be a Balik Eskwela program again for August 15 to 26. So we ordered our regional and district offices nationwide to coordinate with the respective school heads in the respective areas to give priority activities for disinfection of schools and its surroundings, repair of bus areas, painting of pedestrian lanes near fronting the school, declogging of drainage, cleaning of manholes, repair of entrance gates, repair of dilapidated chairs and classroom ceilings, trimming of trees, and fixing of electrical facilities. So, however, we merong add-on kami dito sa Balik Eskwela program for 2022 and 2023. We require our district offices to identify two schools, each district office, yung do sa mga remote areas where we can do some outreach program. Dito may tree planting, provision of school supplies for enrollees, kids haircut, may food packs, may recycling program, may school grounds improvement, may book donation, tsaka face masks and alcohols and others na dinidistribute. Next slide. So, all our next slide, please. All our regional and district offices are now coordinating with the public elementary and high schools nationwide to support the conduct of the Oplan Balik Eskwela of DepEd. So, as per instruction of our DPWH Secretary Manuel Bonuan, instructed me to issue an order ordering our regional and district offices across the country to implement maintenance activities and programs in public schools prior to the reopening of face-to-face classes this year. So as a contribution to DepEd's annual OBE program, our implementing offices were instructed once again to undertake measures that would help ensuring smooth and orderly opening of classes. So yearly, DPWH implements various maintenance works in public schools under OBE. Activities include painting or repainting of pedestrian lanes, fronting the schools, declogging, drainage, cleaning of manholes near schools, repair, dilapidated chairs, ceiling, washrooms, entrance gates in coordination with respective school heads. So, dito, for Region 1, next slide please. For Region 1, these are the different district engineering offices with 59 schools participating for the OBE. Next slide. For Region 2, there are about 79 schools that were identified for the OBE. For Region 3, about 8. For Region 4A, about 58. For Region 4B, it's 13. For Region 5, it's 14. For Region 6, it's 4. For Region 10, it's 46. For Region 11, it's 5. For Region 12, it's 5. For Region 13, 59. For Cordillera, it's 51. And for NCR, it's 43. So a total of 425 schools that were coordinated by DPWH for the Oplan Balik Eskwela. And this will be the priority activities that we are going to do. Next slide, please. We are going to disinfect the schools and its surroundings, repair wash areas, painting of pedestrian lanes near fronting school, declogging of drainage, cleaning of manholes, repair of entrance gates, repair of dilapidated chairs and classroom ceilings, trimming of trees, fixing of electrical facilities, repair of tables and blackboards, then painting of classrooms. So these were some of the photos that were taken during those activities nationwide. So yan po sa Baruyan Elementary School, sa Region 1, next, sa Region 2, sa Batanes, next, yan po sa Region 3, sa Lubao, Pampanga, next, sa Region 4A, sa Biron Silva Elementary School, sa Region 4B, sa Marinduque, sa Region 5, sa Dagit Elementary School, sa Region 6, sa Manuel Maravilla Elementary School, sa Region 10, sa Bangkut Elementary School, sa San Jose and San Jose Elementary School, sa Region 11, sa Salvacion Elementary School, at sa Region 13, sa San Vicente Elementary School. So sa Cordillera, we also have the Manabo National High School na nagkaroon ng Oplan Balik Eskwela. So here, also sa NCR, sa Parañaque. So ito po yung mga ginawa nila. And for the outreach program ng Balik Eskwela, we distributed chairs and tables sa Rizal Elementary School, sa Batangas, sa Lipa. Also sa Bulihan Elementary School, we distributed chairs and tables. Sa Bawi Elementary School, chairs and tables. We even had yung party with the enrollees na courtesy of MacDo. So, nagkaroon po ng konting kasayahan yung mga bata. So, next slide please. So, yan, nagkaroon po ng konting kasayahan. Then, sa Region 6, next slide, we had the distribution turnover of face masks and alcohols. Sa Region 10, we have the distribution of chairs. Also, sa Don Carlos Elementary School, donation of construction materials, chairs and tables. Sa Region 11, sa Cuyas Elementary School, nagkaroon din po ng may video. Nagkaroon po dito ng pre-haircut, pre-school supplies, tree planting, at pre-paints na ipinamigay doon sa eskwelahan. Next slide. So, yan po, namigay din po ng mga pintura doon sa mga Tagibo Elementary School, no? Next slide, also some construction materials and paints dito sa Apayao. So, also sa Cordillera, nagkaroon ng distribution ng fabricated desk and distribution of face mask. Next slide. Also, some other schools. Ngayon, there is an earthquake damage that we... Kasama? Next slide, please. Next slide. We also help in assessing the earthquake damage in public schools in Region 1, wherein the number of school damage there is about 205. Estimated cost of damage is about 95.89 million, and estimated cost of restoration is 281 million in Region 1. For Region 2, nagkaroon po ng assessment doon on schools wherein 21 schools were found to be unsafe, restricted for use, while the remaining 329 school buildings only manifested minor cracks on the walls. So of the 21 schools with major damages, 9 are from Cagayan, 6 are from Isabela and Quirino, while Batanes and Nueva Vizcaya have no reported major damage. So the corresponding 21 million is urgently needed for the immediate repair of the 21 schools reported with major damages. So sa Cordillera naman, where we had the epicenter, the total cost, estimated cost of damage is 3.8 million. However, the estimated cost of restoration is about 5.9 million. So that's all po sa report ng DPWH on the Balik Iskwel program. Thank you po.
Maraming salamat po, Assistant Secretary Antonio V. Molano Jr. mula po sa Department of Public Works and Highways. Ngayon naman po ay ating panoorin at pakinggan ang presentation mula po sa PAGASA, ang Philippine Atmospheric Geophysical and Astronomical Services Administration, to be led by our Chief from the Weather Division, Sir Juanito S. Galang.
Magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. In behalf of PAGASA, we're going to present some information na maaari po makatulong hindi lang dito sa school opening, pati na rin po sa preparation or sa buong school year ng 2022. Kasama ko rin po pala rito umaten yung PAGASA Regional Services Division Chief ng National Capital Region, si Dr. Bonifacio Pawelas. Andiyan po siya sa likod. Next slide po. So, ito po yung outline ng presentation. Next slide po. So just to give you an idea, lahat po ng bagyong dumaan sa ating Philippine Air of Responsibility simula 1948 hanggang 2021, kapag ipinlat po natin, halos ganyan po yung makikita natin. Ang halos wala lang pong ganong naapektuhan itong bandang southern part ng Mindanao, pero itong Luzon, Visayas at northern part ng Mindanao halos natatakpan na po ng bagyo. So in total, 935 tropical cyclone po ang dumaan sa atin from January to December 1948 to 2021. Next slide po. So ito naman po, pinlat namin yung bagyo lang sa August mula 1948 hanggang 2021. So a total of 126 tropical cyclone ang dumaan po sa atin. Next slide po. So for the school opening, August 15 to 26 of the month of August mula 1948 to 2021, pinlat din po namin at 48 tropical cyclone ang dumaan po sa ating Philippine Area of Responsibility. Next slide po. So, kung makikita po natin yung right figure mula January hanggang December, yan po yung normal na bagyo, yung mga track na from January to December. So, mapapansin po natin dito na mula July, August, September, October, November, halos sa dumadami po talaga yung tropical cyclone occurrences dito sa ating bansa. So yung first image, yung upper left, yun po yung forecast natin for August, September, October, November, December, and January. So this August, 2 or 3, as well as September, 2 to 4 ng October, 2 to 3 ng November, 1 or 2 ng December, at hanggang isang bagyo po sa January 2023. So, base po dito sa graph, dito sa bandang ibaba na bandang July, August, September yung peak talaga ng bagyo dito sa ating bansa. Next slide po. So, ito po information lang ng mga normal rainfall. Ibig sabihin po, 30-year average po ito ng mga paulan o rainfall dito sa buong bansa. So, makikita po natin sa mga susunod na image mula January hanggang December, generally, maulan po yung buong Pilipinas talaga. Nagkakaroon lang po ng concentration, kung saan ng concentration ng paulan. So, for January and February, makikita po natin na yung eastern section ng ating bansa mula Luzon, Visayas hanggang Mindanao, ang concentration ng mga malalakas na concentration ng mga paulan, this is due to the occurrence po ng Northeast Monsoon o yung amihan natin. Next slide po. So, March and April, makikita po natin medyo huminang konti, pero ang concentration pa rin po dito sa may eastern section ng ating bansa. Next slide po. For May and June, medyo nag-balance na. Pumapasok na po rito yung southwest, kaya kung makikita po natin halos sa kalat na yung mga paulan, at mapapansin po natin sa bandang June, nagsishift na dito sa western section ang concentration ng mga malalakas na paulan. Next slide po. During July and August, very significant na po yung concentration. Makikita po natin dito sa may eastern part ng Luzon, ang malakas na yung pangapaulan, pati na rin po yung Visayas. Next slide po. So, September, October, ganun pa rin po, apektado pa rin ng southwest monsoon, kaya nandito pa rin sa western section ang concentration ng mga malakas na paulan. So, October, nagkakaroon ng transition period, kaya kumakalat na naman ang mga paulan. Next slide po. So, for November, December, nagsisip po uli sa may eastern section due to the northeast monsoon. Next slide po. So, ito po yung mga PAGASA early warning system. Next slide po. So, meron po tayong thunderstorm advisory, yung thunderstorm warning level mula information, watch, and advisory. Ito po yung ini-issue ng mga PRSD offices natin every 3 hours. Next slide po. So, meron din po tayong heavy rainfall warning system. Ito po yung may kulay na. Meron po tayong yellow rainfall, orange, and red rainfall warning. Next slide. At minodify din po natin yung ating tropical cyclone wind signal. Simula this March, in-implement na po natin yung bagong classification, pati yung signal. Next slide po. Ito na po yung ating bagong, ito yung revised category, yung ating super typhoon category. Binabaan na rin po natin sa 185 km per hour or higher. Dati po kasi nasa 225 km per hour yung ating super typhoon category. Next slide po. So, next slide po. So, para sa additional information, maaari po mag-visit sa Twitter ng DOST PAGASA, sa Facebook, DOST underscore PAGASA, at sa YouTube, DOST PAGASA Weather Report, at yung website po namin, bagong.pagasa.dost.gov.ph. At para po maka-receive nung mga heavy rainfall warning, yung sinabi ko kanina, pwede po magbigay ng either Viber number or email address para po mabigay natin ng mas mabilis ito pong warning na inilalabas po ng PAGASA. Yun lamang po. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat po, Sir Juanito S. Galang, para po sa inyong presentasyon patungkol na po sa ating pagsisiguro ng kaligtasan. Para naman po sa aspeto ng transportasyon, makakasama po natin ang Department of Transportation or DOTR sa pangunguna ng ating Chairman of Land Transportation, Franchising and Regulatory Board, Attorney Shaloy Valicaria Garafil.
Yusek Dancing, Yusek Escobedo, Attorney Poa, and all the representatives ng ating partner agencies ngayon and members of the media, good morning po sa inyong lahat. With your permission, in behalf of Yusek Stephen Pastor, please allow me to present to you the updates on the initiatives being undertaken by the DOTR in preparation for the opening of classes next week and the face-to-face classes in November. Next slide, please. As already mentioned, the formal opening of classes will start on Monday, and we expect that 100 in-person classes by November 22 will be implemented, since other modes of learning, such as blended learning, will not anymore be allowed. Next slide, please. So the objectives of the DOTR. To ensure a safe, efficient, comfortable public transport system to our commuters and our students are the following. Ensure sufficient supply of PUVs to meet the anticipated increase in passenger demand. Ensure route responsiveness to the influx of students returning to face-to-face classes. Strict implementation of road traffic laws to prevent unwanted injuries on the road. Promote the use of active transportation for students and teachers going to and from school. Provide free rides to students through the Libreng Sakay program in the EDSA busway and LRT2. And strictly implement the 20% fare discount for students during weekdays, weekends, and holidays. Next slide, please. So to implement these objectives, we have the following road sector initiatives. Our main focus is to improve the deployment of PUV units. This includes reopening of non-EDSA pre-pandemic routes. For these routes to be responsive, we are identifying appropriate endpoints and transfer points for selected PUV routes to cater to different areas in Metro Manila. In support of this, as already mentioned, we will open additional routes to ensure that the increase in passenger demand will be met with enough supply of PUVs. To supplement PUV deployment, we have allowed the resumption of school bus operation not only in NCR but all over the country. In support of our school bus operators, we have waived their penalties for non-confirmation of their units for the 2 years that they have been not been operational, and extended the lifespan of units that have reached 15 years to another 2 years to help our operators and drivers. Road safety is also one of our top priorities. Hence, the implementation of the Balik Eskwela initiative with government enforcement agencies and road safety private partners to deploy enforcers at school zones nationwide. In the NCR, the LTFRB will set up 8 one-stop shop help desks in strategic areas around major school zones as early as August 17 to assist operators, drivers, and commuters alike on concerns regarding deployment of PUVs, as well as ensure that road users abide by existing road traffic laws. To promote the use of active transportation, we also are coordinating with DepEd and CHED to direct institutions to provide end-of-trip facilities for our students and teachers who want to bike to schools and their places of work. Lastly, we are strictly implementing the 20% fare student discount in PUVs, even in our train systems for students to avail of. Next slide, please. So based on the LTFRB distribution of land transport service report for May 2022, the LTFRB has allowed operations of most, if not all, units with CPC and even opened new routes to cater to the demand. In summary, there are 926 routes across 4 modes, meaning for the city bus, for the city P2P, for the jeepney, both traditional and modern, and UV Express. This represents 74,899 units. All in all, if we're going to add the TNVS, shuttle service, and the school transport system, we'll have 127,032 units. And for the school bus, we have 3,249 operating for this school year. Next slide, please. On the reopening of routes, we are for the retention of the EDSA busway with the original 550 units, and we are set to add 100 more units to be operated by another consortium. And as already mentioned earlier, we will restore with modification the pre-pandemic non-EDSA PUB routes and retain and modify the other operational GCQ routes to avoid multiple transfer of commuters. So in summary, these are the initial recommendations for the routes for retention or modification. For the PUB, we are adding or we are reopening 32 routes, for the jeepneys 67 routes, and for the UV Express 31 routes, or a total of 130 routes. Next slide, please. We still have the Libreng Sakay program in the EDSA busway, which will run until the end of the year, and the LRT2 for students, which will run from August 22 to November 4, 2022. Next slide, please. And as mentioned, 20% discount will be strictly enforced in all PUVs. Next slide, please. And lastly, the LTFRB, the LTO, the DILG, the PNP, MMDA, and the IAC, and its enforcement personnel will be deployed at strategic PUV locations and school zones to ensure compliance of PUV drivers and operators with road traffic laws and health and safety protocols. That's all for the DOTR, sir.
Maraming salamat po, Attorney Shelloy. After the DOTR, we have the LTO, the Land Transportation Office, to be led by the Supervising Transportation Regulation Officer, Mr. Manuel Kalima.
Good morning po sa atin lahat. Ako po si Manuel Kalima, Deputy Chief for Operation po ng Field Enforcement Division, Law Enforcement Service, LTO. Ito pa po ang aming programa sa LTO Plan Balik Eskwela 2022. Next slide, please. To give you a background, the LTO office in partnership with other traffic enforcement agencies will undertake its annual Plan Balik Eskwela 2022 to ensure roadworthiness of public transportation and school services as well as assist in traffic management along schools located along major thoroughfares and traffic stop points. In the implementation of Balik Eskwela 2022, LTO will maintain visibility of law enforcement officers or LEOs in areas identified as densely populated schools per list of deathbed to prevent any violation of land transportation rules and regulations. Mali, ito po ay ginagawa namin taon-taon. Maliban lang po sa taon na to, kasi meron na pong tayong coordination with other government agencies, especially po sa DepEd. Ang nangyayari po kasi, kung kailan yung first day of classes, yun lang yung time na magipag-coordinate kami sa mga school. Tapos napagkakamalan pa kami yung mga brigada, eskwela. Akala ng mga principal, tutulong kami sa paglilinis ng eskwelahan. Kasi yun po ang ginagawa ng mga police at BFP. Yung expected situation po, yung next slide please. There will be an increase of public transportation demand and proliferation of colorum operation, unregistered, overloaded, unsafe, dilapidated, and other illegally operated motor vehicles such as school services. Traffic congestion along major roads leading to schools. Mali sa experience na po namin, kung nasan po kami na area, lumilinis po yung kalsada. Kasi pwede kaming mag-inspeksyon. Kung ano yung ginagawa mo pag nirehistro mo yung sasakyan, pwede naming ulitin sa kalsada mismo. Kaya nagkakaroon po ng disiplina. Next slide please. Ito po yung action plan namin. There will be a nationwide simultaneous implementation of Plan Balik Eskwela 2022 from August 19 to September 2, 2022 with the following activities. Number one, intensify the nationwide conduct of terminal inspection prior to the official start of the opening classes. Increase visibility of LTO layouts in predetermined areas where major schools are located. Assist in traffic direction and control in case of traffic jams. Conduct of roadside operations against dilapidated, overloaded, unregistered, and colorum school service vehicles. Conduct verification of driver's license and motor vehicles registration. And coordinate with other participating agencies to provide safety and security measures to motors and passengers and other road users. Next slide, please. With regard to reporting and monitoring, we will issue a memorandum directing all LTO regional offices to submit the following documents: implementing and corresponding communications plan to ensure safe, secure, reliable, and convenient transport systems during the monitored travel period. List of specific areas under your jurisdiction that the secretary and or the underside may visit to evaluate the progress of the plan. And we will activate the 24/7 LTO operations or coordination center to ensure open and direct communication lines to the LTO central office. Posting of periodic situational reports and real-time updates to the LES Coordination Center Viber Group. And the submission of post-plan report not later than September 6, 2022 for consolidation and submission to the Department of Transportation to include photos, videos, and or other forms of evidences. Next slide, please. This will be the personal, our strength in this implementation of Bakplan Malik Eskwela 2022. In Region 1, we have 36 enforcers, Region 2, 32, Region 3, 14, Region 4, 16, Region 4, 73, Region 5, 92, Region 6, 13, Region 7, 4, Region 8, 74, Region 9, 44, Region 10, 35 enforcers, Region 11, 42, Region 12, 16, Caraga 8, CAR 13, NCR East 236, NCR West 16, Central Office 44 with a total of 808 enforcers. And patrol cars, vehicles to be deployed, Region 1, 4, Region 2, 8, Region 3, 4, Region 4, A5, Region 4, B3, Region 5, 2, Region 6, 3, Region 7, 3, Region 8, 4, Region 9, 5, Region 10, 6, Region 11, 4, Region 12, 3, Caraga, 2, CAR, 4, NCR, East, 5, NCR West, 3, Central Office, 10, with a total of 78 patrol vehicles. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yan. Thank you po.
Maraming salamat po, Sir Manuel Kalima, for your presentation about the plans and programs of Land Transportation Office for the 2022 Upland Balik Eskwela. After that, we have the Metro Manila Development Authority, or MMDA, to be presented by their Director 3, Director Naomi T. Rasho.
Good morning po. I'm representing our Acting Chairman, Carlo Di Mayuga, because he cannot make it this morning. I'm Director Naomi Rasho, MMDA's Traffic Engineering Center and Traffic Discipline Office. So, for MMDA, we prepared an audio-video presentation for our Balik Eskwela program. So, please do watch and listen. Thank you po.
MMDA Upland Balik Eskwela 2022. The Metropolitan Manila Development Authority is one of the partner agencies of Department of Education's Upland Balik Eskwela Interagency Task Force, which is tasked to provide guidelines on health and safety, peace and order, traffic and transport management, and other forms of support to ensure a safe and orderly opening of classes in August. Operational plan. The MMDA will deploy 2,238 personnel along major roads and within the vicinities of high-density schools in Metro Manila. Out of the 2,238 personnel, 581 traffic enforcers will be dispatched to 146 schools in the National Capital Region to ensure the safe resumption of 100% face-to-face classes. 7 ambulances and 40 tow trucks shall be on standby in case any untoward incident happens. A total of 6 buses and 2 military trucks are being deployed for the Libreng Sakay to help the public on their daily commute. The buses would ferry commuters from Doña Carmen Commonwealth to Welcome Rotonda España from 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. Mondays through Fridays. Meanwhile, the Pasig River Ferry Service, an alternative mode of transportation operated by the MMDA, continuously offers free rides for commuters. It operates from Mondays to Saturdays from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. Traffic Enforcement Group. The MMDA's Traffic Enforcement Group is tasked to implement traffic rules and regulations. Metro Base, the MMDA's command center, will also monitor 24/7 the traffic situation throughout the entire metropolis, supported by high-definition CCTV cameras installed at key locations. Last June, the MMDA met with the school administrators, parent-teacher associations, Philippine National Police, and local traffic bureaus in the National Capital Region to discuss road safety contingencies at school zones. Traffic Engineering Center. The MMDA Traffic Engineering Center is in charge of the application of thermoplastic pavement markings and installation of road signages within various public schools in the metropolis. Likewise, TEC personnel have also started installing informative road signs such as parking and no parking, school zone, and bully-free zone. SCOG and MPCG. Members of Sidewalk Clearing Operations Group regularly conduct road clearing aimed to remove obstructions encroaching the sidewalk. Moreover, the MMDA accommodated requests for assistance from schools in cleaning their premises. Personnel from the Metro Parkways Clearing Group conducted misting or anti-dengue operations, fogging, cleaning, roof gutter declogging, planting, and pruning of trees. Flood Control and Sewerage Management Office. Flood mitigation activities, which include the clogging of drainages within the vicinity of schools and cleaning up of waterways such as creeks and esteros, are being done all year round by the agency's Flood Control and Sewerage Management Office. Identified choke points. The MMDA is anticipating a slowdown of traffic during the opening of classes on August 22. Hence, additional traffic personnel would be deployed on identified traffic choke points with high number of students and vehicles, such as Immaculate Conception Academy, Xavier School, and La Salle along Ortigas Avenue, Philippine Science High School in Agam Road, Quezon City, Miriam College, and Ateneo de Manila University along Katipunan, Quezon City, and St. Pedro Poveda College on EDSA.
That's all po, and thank you po for watching.
Maraming salamat po. And lastly, we have the Department of National Defense or DND, Office of Civil Defense, the Officer in Charge Public Affairs Office, Mr. Mark Cashin Timbal.
Yusek Densing, sir. Good morning. Yusek Escobredo, attorney po. Good morning. And to all my colleagues here, good morning po. Mula po sa amin sa National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council, sa DND and the Office of Civil Defense, nagpapasalamat po kami sa inyo pong imbitasyon para makasama po kami dito sa pagpupulong balitaan na ito. Wala po kami presentation, pero iuulat ko po sa inyo na tuloy po ang suporta ng ating NDRRMC, lahat po ng mga ahensya nito kasama ang Department of National Defense sa pagsasagawa po ng ating Opland Balik Eskwela 2022. Ang ating pong pangangalaga sa ating mga estudyante sa larangan po ng disaster management ay patuloy. Yung ating pong mga warnings na pinapadala kapag meron pong impending na panganib, natural hazard kagaya ng bagyo, paglindol, possibility ng landslide at pagbaha, ito po ay tuloy-tuloy na pinapadala sa ating mga mamamayan, kasama din sa ating mga pinunong lokal at ang ating mga pinuno administrador ng mga eskwelahan. Ang ating pong pagsasanay po sa disaster control groups ng ating mga eskwelahan ay tuloy pong isinasagawa ng Office of Civil Defense. Bilang bahagi po nito ay ang pagsasagawa po ng pagpaplano for public service continuity planning, at kasama po dito yung ating incident command management system na itinuturo sa ating mga disaster managers. Yung pagsasagawa po natin ng earthquake drill ay tuloy-tuloy po kahit po may pandemic. Ang ating pong susunod na earthquake drill na kasama po ang lahat ng mga eskwelahan ay gagawin sa September 8. Excited po kami sa NDRRMC dahil noong panahon po ng pandemic, online po ang ating mga NSED. At ang ating mga bata ay nagda-duck cover and hold lang po sa kanilang mga tahanan. Pero ngayon po, balik eskwela na po sila, at physical po nating makikita yung kanilang pagtalima dito sa ating plano para masigurado na ang kanilang kaligtasan sa earthquake ay andyan. Bilang pagtulong din po dahil sa plano ng pamahalaan na hindi na po gamitin ang mga eskwelahan bilang evacuation center, ano po, para hindi mapatid po yung pag-aaral ng ating mga estudyante pag may ganito pong natural hazards, nagpatayo po ang ating pamahalaan ng higit sa 100 na mga dedicated evacuation centers sa iba't ibang mga rehiyon dito sa ating bansa. Ito pong mga ito ay isinisituate doon sa mga ligtas na lugar, hindi abot ng baha,
Ang building po ay matatag sa earthquake, hindi basta-basta ang liliparin ng bagyo ang bubong. At ang mga pasilidad po nito, meron po tayong sapat na bilang ng mga latrine facilities o palikuran. Meron pong enough space para sa tutuluyan ng mga mag-evacuate. At meron din pong mga continuing education facilities para yung mga na-displace po nating mga kabataan ay makapagpatuloy ng pag-aaral mismo doon sa ating mga evacuation center. Nagpapasalamat po tayo sa mga kasamahan natin sa Department of Public Works and Highways dahil po sa kanilang patuloy na pagsusuri doon sa mga building po na na-damage nitong nakalipas na earthquake diyan po sa Abra. At patuloy po ang ating pakikipag-ugnayan sa local government units doon sa area para po masigurado po na kapag na-assess na po natin ang buong buo itong mga affected areas po na ito, lalo na yung mga eskwelahan, daglian po nating mabuo ang ating recovery and rehabilitation plan for all those affected areas. Nagpapasalamat po tayo dahil ang ating Department of Education ay patuloy na ini-implement po yung ating disaster management and disaster education programs doon sa ating curriculum for science and in other subjects, including na din po yung civic awareness ng ating mga kabataan. These are all being implemented po sa pakikipagtulungan ng ating NDRRMC and the Department of Education at tuloy-tuloy po itong isasagawa ng ating kawanihan para po sa ating mga kababayan. Ang protection naman po ng ating mga kabataan para sa COVID-19, tuloy-tuloy po ang pag-uusap sa atin sa NDRRMC para po sa eksaktong mga responsibilidad na ililipat po ng National Task Force Against COVID-19 dito sa NDRRMC level. At kasama pa rin po dyan ang pagsasagawa ng iba't ibang mga ahensya ng kanilang mga tungkulin batay sa kanilang mandato. For example po, sa atin sa Office of Civil Defense, katulong ang ating mga kasamahan sa Sandataang Lakas ng Pilipinas, ang ating suporta po sa DOH in terms of the transportation of the vaccine specimens or vaccine supply ay ating pong tuloy na isinasagawa. Ang pagmamando din po at pangangalaga sa mga quarantine facilities na itinatag ng pamahalaan na ituloy-tuloy po nating isinasagawa. Sa aking pong pagkakaalam, wala na po atang eskwelahan na ginagamit na quarantine facility po ngayon. Kaya nagpapasalamat po tayo dahil ang ating mga kababayan ay tuloy-tuloy ang pag-iingat laban sa COVID-19. Despite the fact po na medyo mayroon pong konting pagtaas sa numero ng ating mga kababayan na nagkakasakit ngayon, tuloy pa rin po ang rollout ng ating vaccination program at yung mga kabataan po natin na kailangan na pong magpabakuna ay patuloy po nating inaanyayahan, hinihimok ang kanilang mga magulang na isagawa po itong pagbabakuna na ito para may dagdag protection po tayo. Pero hindi po ibig sabihin noon na magiging magpapakakampante tayo at hindi na mag-iingat kahit bakunado na. Tayo po ay ating pinapasabihan pa rin po, inaabisuhan na ang pag-iingat po sa COVID-19 ay dapat ipagpatuloy po, lalo na sa ating mga eskwelahan. At ang ating mga kaguruan po ay nabigyan naman po ng karampatang pagsasanay ng ating mga health officials ano po, patungkol po dito sa pangangalaga na ito. At ano pa ba? I think that's all. At maraming salamat po sa ating mga kasamahan. Good morning po.
Maraming salamat din po, Sir Mark Asyantimbal mula po sa Department of National Defense. Ngayon naman po ating pakinggan ang presentation mula naman po sa ating partner agencies for support in terms of communication. We have our Department of Interior and Local Government to be led by our Undersecretary for Plans, Public Affairs and Communication, Attorney Margarita N. Gutierrez.
Hi. Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Secretary Benjamin Abalos Jr., I would like to present the initiatives and preparations of the Department and Interior Local Government for a safe and orderly return of our students and teachers to our schools. DILG expresses its full support for the Oplan Balik Eskwela of the Department of Education, led by Secretary Vice President Sara C. Duterte. Such support is manifested through the deployment of the available assets, resources, and manpower of the Philippine National Police, the Bureau of Fire Protection, Bureau of Jail Management and Penology, and even our regional and field officials who shall extend assistance to our local government units to ensure their full participation to the program. Apart from mobilizing the barangay tanod and force multipliers on the streets and thoroughfares leading to schools and in schools itself, our LGUs shall also assist and encourage our kababayans to avail of the COVID-19 vaccines for qualified learners and parents. Next slide, please. Okay, given that we are not yet entirely free from COVID-19, we shall strictly enforce the minimum public health standards among our personnel and those going back to school, as well as the parents and guardians. Last July, the department has issued Memorandum Circular Number 2022-098, enjoining all operating arms of the department and the LGUs to provide the necessary assistance for the implementation of Oplan Balik Eskwela. Next slide, please, there. Among the key points of the said policy issuance, especially for the LGUs, are the strict enforcement of public health standards and protocols, close coordination with the PNP and BFP to ensure peace and order and safety, mobilization of the barangays and the tanods and other volunteers for traffic management and other related functions, coordination with DepEd and other relevant agencies to ensure structural integrity and soundness of school facilities, conduct cleanup and information drives on the prevention of dengue outbreak. So further, LGUs should also ensure that private schools and educational institutions have the necessary permits and licenses to operate. Likewise, the LGUs will be reminded to make use of their respective special education fund for the construction, repair, and rehabilitation of schools and facilities in their respective jurisdictions. Also, the DILG, through the Philippine National Police, the Bureau of Fire Protection and Bureau of Jail Management and Penology are tasked to coordinate with LGUs in deploying and mobilizing their assets, resources, and manpower to provide assistance during the opening of classes. These assets and personnel shall be stationed in strategic locations proximate to learning institutions in accordance with DepEd Order Number 32, Series of 2019, or the National Policy Framework on Learners and Schools as Zones of Peace. Next slide. As additional directives to our LGUs, they shall assist and collaborate with local health units in the administration of COVID-19 booster shots in accordance with the existing Department of Health and DepEd guidelines. They shall also wage an information campaign on the pediatric vaccination activities of the government. The LGUs will be coordinating with the Metro Manila Development Authority and relevant government offices in preparing alternate route plans for affected vehicles passing near schools due to the opening of classes. In order to maintain the pedestrian safety along the sidewalk, LGUs will also be reminded to clear the streets and sidewalks from any obstruction that could endanger the lives of students, parents, and school personnel. With these initiatives and through our close coordination and engagement with DepEd and other partner government agencies, we are optimistic that the return of the face-to-face classes will be safe, peaceful, and orderly for everyone concerned. So that's it, and thank you at magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat.
Thank you so much po, Attorney Margarita N. Gutierrez mula po sa Department of Interior and Local Government. Next to our presentation is from the Office of the Press Secretary, OPS, to be led by our Director 4, Director Jeannie Dominguez Ednalan.
Good morning, Yusek Densing, Yusek Escobedo, Attorney Poa, and to all my fellow public servants here, and also to the public that is listening. On behalf of our secretary, the press secretary, Trixie Cruz Angeles, who just announced that she tested positive for COVID today, she is asymptomatic naman po, so she will just isolate and continue to work from home. I would just like to share a very short statement of support from the OPS for the DepEd's OBE. The Office of the Press Secretary has been supportive of the Oplan Balik Eskwela of the Department of Education since our Vice President, the DepEd Secretary, announced the resumption of face-to-face classes, and also when the President gave the directive to support the DepEd's pronouncement. The Office of the Press Secretary has been full force in helping DepEd. The Office of the Press Secretary has been full force in helping DepEd raise the public confidence for the face-to-face classes by highlighting all efforts of different government agencies to make sure that our schools, educators, students, and other systems are ready and safe when we start the 100% face-to-face classes on November. All the Oplan Balik Eskwela efforts have been disseminated to the public through the state's broadcast and digital media assets. Through the private support, the OBE will also be featured in several out-of-home platforms. Of course, the regular press briefings of the Press Secretary, Attorney Trixie Cruz Angeles, has also been a great platform for the DepEd and other members of the OBE interagency convergence, such as the DILG and the DOH, to discuss their OBE efforts. The Office of the Press Secretary will continue to support the Department of Education by bringing to the public legitimate information about the whole of government approach for the success of the Oplan Balik Eskwela. Thank you.
Thank you so much po, Director Jeannie Dominguez Ednalan from the Office of the Press Secretary. Also, we have the support from the National Telecommunications Commission headed by our Chief from the Services and Interconnection Division Regulation Branch. We have Engineer Ruben B. Valeros.
Good morning, everyone. As we have not prepared a presentation for this activity, but nonetheless, as a partner of the Oplan Balik Eskwela of the Department of Education, the National Telecommunications Commission would like to express its sincere support to the said Oplan activity of the DepEd. For its part, the NTC will issue a memorandum directing all public telecommunications entities, mobile network operators, internet service providers to ensure a stable and reliable internet connection, which is very essential for DepEd's smooth implementation of the OBE and for an orderly conduct of online school opening active programs and future activities through various social media and digital platforms. Guided by the mandate, vision, and mission, as the regulator of telecommunications and broadcast services in the country, the NTC will continue to work hand in hand with our mother agency, the Department of Information and Communications Technology, industry partners, and stakeholders in order to provide better telecommunications and information and communications technology services the general public so deserves. Thank you po.
Maraming salamat po, Engineer Ruben. At hindi lang po sila ang makakasama natin. Kasama rin po natin ngayon ang ating iba pang partner agencies in providing other services relevant sa ating Oplan Balik Eskwela at ang ating mga paaralan. Nandito po nangunguna ang ating Department of Energy or DOE to be presented by their Senior Science Research Specialist, Engineer Angelo Africa.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting the Department of Energy. And on behalf of Secretary Lotilia, let me present the initiatives and plans of the department in preparation for the opening of classes school year 2022 to 2023. For background, let me present that the DOE's actions during the past 2 years of the pandemic. And the DOE has issued a number of advisories and policies in order to ensure that there will be stable and sufficient supply of electricity, not only for the present but also in the years to come. This includes advisories in ensuring the unimpeded delivery of energy services, issuance of official COVID-19 interagency task force, identification cards and QR codes to frontline power industry personnel, endorsements to allow the entry of foreign experts and consultants with critical roles in the power sector operations and power development and implementation, advisory to all power generation companies and distribution utilities to ensure reliable and stable electricity, and Administrative Order 2021-05-0001, providing the COVID-19 response protocol for the energy sector. Next slide, please. For our 2022 power situation, with the resumption of the operation of major industries in the country since last year, it has been anticipated that the country's power demand will increase towards the normal level or even higher. Furthermore, the start of face-to-face classes will definitely contribute to a higher demand, shifting from household loads to schools and universities. Thus, the DOE is closely monitoring the committed power projects as addition to our country's power supply mix. And based on our power situation, the DOE assures that there will be enough energy and reserve capacity to accommodate the demand of Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao until the end of this year. Next slide, please. In case of unavoidable power interruption, the DOE has already established the monitoring and coordination protocol for the operation of generation, transmission, and distribution facilities, especially in times of these unavoidable outages. So the DOE will be coordinating with the concerned stakeholders to gather information on the cause of interruption and estimated resumption of operation. If necessary, the DOE can intervene and aid affected stakeholders to expedite the repair of facilities in order to provide the needed electricity to the end users. And as closing, the Department of Energy, along with its partner stakeholders, including Meralco here, will provide support to the Department of Education by continuing to monitor the entire energy sector during the pandemic season and ensure unimpeded delivery of energy services to all customers, especially to all schools and households that will need uninterrupted electricity supply to both face-to-face and virtual or distance learning platform for the students this school year. That's all. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po, Engineer Africa. After that, kaagapay din po natin ang Department of Information and Communications Technology or DICT to be presented by the Assistant Secretary for Upskilling, ASEC, Jeffrey Ian CD.
Naimbag nga bigat, kada kayo amin. Magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. Good morning. In behalf of our Secretary, Secretary Ivan John Enrile Uy, let me present to you our preparations as part of our assistance to DepEd for Oplan Balik Eskwela 2022. Next slide, please. So, basically, there are two pillars that we are providing for DepEd, capacity building and connectivity and access. These are under the Public Education Network, also known as PEN, which is a program established in 2020 to strengthen the delivery of education through broadcast connectivity and digital security. The PEN program is a step forward toward the digitalization of the education sector of the country and aims to fast-track the digital connectivity of all public schools and DepEd offices nationwide and allow learners more complete access to DepEd projects and other learning platforms. So now we will discuss the first one, which is capacity building. Next slide. There are two capacity building development projects that the ICT has developed for teachers, students, and non-teaching personnel. The first one is Digital Learners Project, which is shown on the screen, or DLP. The other one is Digital Jobs PH, primarily for teachers and maybe for senior high. No? Under DLP, we have the massively open online courses. These are online courses available for teachers, non-teaching personnel, and even to our students. In these massively open online courses, we offer three major courses: STEM Education Master Course for Teachers, Action Research, and Cyber Safe Practices, or Cyber Safe Philippines. Next slide. Let's talk about STEM Education Master Courses for Teachers. In the slide, four programs are enumerated. Let me just reiterate that these are for free, and these are open, and these are asynchronous type of learning that are available for teachers and non-training personnel of DepEd. So under the STEM education, we have those courses that are shown, and you will notice that those are mostly in digital content creation, digital cooperation, and data literacy or data analytics. The next part of I would like to present is the action research, again available through our MOOCs or massive open online courses. The goal here is for participants to develop a research proposal, no? So while this is asynchronous, this is usually trainer led, and the teachers or non-teaching personnel or research assistants of DepEd, they are given training and a more practical way of developing a research based on the training tools that was provided. So you will notice enumerated in the screen, the training being provided are more about research, project-based learning, as intervention for teaching and learning issues, digital technologies and data collection again, data analysis, and digital resources and research proposal write-up. Next slide. Cyber safe practices. Oh, this is again MOOCs available online as an asynchronous training. This is important because if DepEd is to offer hybrid training, it is important that we also aim not only our teachers, our non-teaching personnel, but also our students, especially yung little ones, ano, on how to properly behave in the internet. Alam niyo naman yung ating mga estudyante, pag binigyan mo na yan ng access sa mga computers, hindi mo na alam kung saan sila pupunta. So it is important that we teach them the basics of cyber hygiene. What is cyber security? What is cyberspace? And also be on the lookout for predatory practices, cyberbullying also. Not to click kapag hindi nila alam yung mga links that are being shown to them via chat, etc., etc. So these courses, 10 modules for teachers and non-teaching personnel, but we also offer yung mga basic cyber hygiene for kids para ma-prepare sila sa kanilang online world. Next slide. This one is synchronous, no? So this is not asynchronous. This is not part of MOOCs. So we just would like to state that the ICT also offers through the ICLDB, the ICT competency, the ICT Literacy and Competency Development Bureau, offers ICT specialized training for teachers, students, and non-teaching personnel. Okay, so these are synchronous training, but are also delivered online. Next slide. We also offered, although these are not ICT-related training, these are more about health. Yung previous slide, I'm sorry. The previous one, yeah. We would just like to state that the Digital Learners Project of the ICT also offers synchronous trainings that are meant to support our mental and health well-being. These are, again, online courses, but these are synchronous, which means we have to schedule this, and there is a online trainer facilitating the training. So makikita niyo dyan yung You Matter, which is everyone deserves excellent mental health, the healthy self, etc., etc. For the next part for our next project, this is Digital PH. These are ICT specialized trainings with partnership to Facebook. Again, these are synchronous trainings in partnership with Facebook and Microsoft. So nandiyan yung Facebook Digital Tayo, another synchronous training. So therefore, may facilitator. Go Philippines, which is a blended, synchronous, and 1-2 hour per session na may modules. Yung Go Philippines, you can also obtain certifications with the assistance of Microsoft. So yung mga, I understand that we're still a Microsoft, karamihan sa ginagamit natin are Windows and Microsoft. So this is also important for for teachers, non-teachers, and also for our senior high. So available din yung mga Microsoft certifications through the Go Philippines digital ICT specialized trainings. Next slide. Now, digital jobs PH training for teachers, actually, pwede rin ito sa senior high. Ano? Yung digital jobs training, these are more for upskilling people so that they can offer jobs online. Yung mga outsourced jobs. So kung, halimbawa, wala kang work na pumapasok ka ng opisina araw-araw or gusto mo mag-remote work, these are the type of trainings that we provide so that they, I think you're already familiar with mga online, they get your services online and they pay you also online. And so you will notice that the trainings here are more for graphic design with Canva. Yung mga sikat ngayon na mga ICT jobs or knowledge jobs available for remote jobs, remote workers. So here we mostly offer graphic design, social media marketing, and online virtual assistants. Now I think the next part is for the other one, no? Which is yung connectivity and access. To date, we already have 679. This is about the free Wi-Fi project. We already have provided 679 access for public elementary schools, 273 for public high schools, and we also have available more than 2,000, I think this is more than 2,400, Tech for Ed centers. The Tech for Ed centers are actually digital laboratories which our students and teachers can use. This is also equipped with internet access so they can use it for facilitating trainings and also for going online for research, etc., etc. As of August 5, 2022, not in the screen, but we would like to report that there are also 4,585 operational sites in 75 provinces and 588 localities for the free Wi-Fi. This already serves approximately 3 million users. The breakdown is we have 2,993 public live sites, 1,592 sites offered in public schools, EDUCs, and TESDA, and 24 that are located in geographically isolated in disadvantaged areas or GIDA barangays. For the coming year, we are targeting an additional 15 nodes in Metro Manila through the NCR Regional Ring, and additional 313 access points to go live in public schools and SUCs throughout the region through our regional IP transport in municipalities project. That's all for the ICT. Thank you very much.
Maraming salamat po, ASEC Jeffrey Ian CD, para sa pagbibigay suporta para sa ating 2022 Upland Balik Eskwela. Then we have, for the Department of Trade and Industry, or DTI, Attorney Ann Claire Sikabot-Chan, Assistant Secretary for the Consumer Protection Group, or CPG.
Thank you and good morning. Thank you to the Department of Education, Yusek Escobedo, Yusek Dinsing, and all the other partner government agencies and from the private sector as well. On behalf of the Department of Trade and Industry, led by Secretary Alfredo Pascual, I would like to register our strong support for the Department of Education for its Balik Eskwela program. The Department of Trade and Industry published just last Friday, August 12, 2022, in the Philippine Star and the People's Journal, the Gabay sa Pamimili ng School Supplies, which is your guide for school supplies. It contains 162 SKUs or stock keeping units composed of notebooks, pad papers, pencils, ball pens, erasers, crayons, sharpeners, and rulers. We hope that, of course, the parents, yung mga magulang po natin, ng ating mga magbabalik eskwela on Monday will use this as a guide. They can go to bookstores and purchase these products that are in our guide with the prices that we have published po. So ito po yung nakalagay natin na SRP, suggested retail price for this basic school supplies. Ngayon po, the DTI has actually been monitoring prices of school supplies since July of this year. And we have been conducting these kwento caravans in various localities all over the country. To date, we have had 21 these kwento caravans, and these would be selling these school supplies at even less than SRP. Kasi po, nakipagtulungan po sa amin yung mga manufacturers ng mga school supplies. So even at below SRP, nakukuha po yan sa diskwento caravan. Between now and the end of August, there will still be 46 diskwento caravans all over the country. So yung aming pong mga colleagues sa regional operations group ay gumagawa din po ng diskwento caravans sa kanilang respective areas of responsibility. In Metro Manila, we will have one tomorrow in Malabon, and on August 31, I think it's going to be in Pasig City. So this guide can be downloaded from the DTI website. We hope that the parents will use it. At doon naman sa ating mga mag-aaral, I hope that they'll also tell their parents na meron po tayong guide nung ating school supplies. And also just to highlight that kami po sa Department of Trade and Industry, especially us in the Consumer Protection Group, we have been working with some of the colleagues of from DepEd because we would like to really ensure that consumer protection is included as part of you know the curriculum at a very young age. Malaki po ang magagawa pag alam ng ating mga mag-aaral not only their rights but only also their responsibilities as consumers. And we have been working, of course, with the National Youth Commission because we believe in empowering the youth on responsible consumerism. So yung sustainable consumption po, when the kids go back to school, they are aware that what they should do with garbage and with also how to dispose them properly, aside from being able to dispose them safely because of still the threats of COVID. So with that, I would say good luck, of course, to DepEd, and we are always here to support DepEd in the Balik Eskwela program. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po, Attorney Kabotsyan.
Our next agency is from the Manila Electric Company, the Meralco, to be presented by the head of the Meralco Home and Microbase North Business Area, Ma'am Maida B. David.
Morning, Yusek Den Singh, Yusek Escobedo, to our partner agencies, to the plenary, good morning. Nagpapasalamat po kami sa imbitasyon upang mailahad ang aming mga gawain para sa patuloy na commitment ng Meralco para sa Opland Balik Eskwela for school year 2022 and 2023. So next slide, please. With 119 years of experience in power distribution, Meralco has always been committed to supporting the Department of Education in improving the learning experience of Filipino learners by providing safe, uninterrupted, and reliable electricity supply. So two key asks from the DepEd was to ensure uninterrupted power supply and to promote electrical safety and energy efficiency. So on the next slide, we would see that to address these, firstly on reliability, in order to ensure reliable service and adequate power supply, we inspect our facilities to ensure that it is compliant to electrical standards. By performing these inspections, we would be able to assess and identify facilities that would need further maintenance or corrections. Secondly, power restoration in situations of interruptions and outages is also a priority and can be assured that immediate assistance will be provided to the schools to ensure that disruptions are minimal. Secondly, extending technical support to schools. This is also in place. Electricity-related issues on the load side or after the meter installations can be conducted by contractors certified by Meralco or CBMs who will be ready to assist should there be electrical repairs needed. Recommendations to the schools will also be provided. Secondly, on the key ask on energy efficiency, promoting electrical safety and energy efficiency is a key initiative. A webinar to discuss electrical safety and efficient use of energy will be conducted. To complement this, an introduction on sustainable technology through solar power brings into awareness innovative measures in being more energy efficient while helping the environment. This online webinar on August 18 is customized for our school principals, teaching and non-teaching staff for schools within the franchise area of Meralco. Secondly, tree trimming activities will also be done wherever necessary. And lastly, energy efficiency tips will also be posted on Meralco's social media platforms and accounts. These would provide easy access and visibility that would further help in disseminating information to the schools. On top of these, and to better support the program, our One Meralco Foundation has been partners with DepEd through various initiatives. And this shall continue to energize more off-grid public schools that are outside Metro Manila, outside the Meralco franchise, and support public schools within the franchise area. On the energization of off-grid public school via solar, One Meralco Foundation, or OMF, will continue to energize select off-grid public schools in remote communities in the country. To date, OMF has already energized 280 schools through solar power panel installations, and in the pipeline for 2022 are 16 installations for schools in Bohol, Camsur, Albay, Iloilo, Antique. And for 2023, the goal is to add 30 more schools with sustainable electricity supply. Aside from these solar installations, multimedia equipment donations from Meralco employees is also given for every school energized. Moreover, for public schools within the Meralco franchise, employees donate back-to-school kits, personal protective equipment, lunch boxes, and tumblers. This is in line with OBE's thrust on keeping safe by necessary health and safety protocols by continuing hygienic practices. This school year, we are giving a total of 3,056 to 61 select schools in the Meralco franchise area. Lastly, our team has also been continuously coordinating with schools to provide contact details to be reached should there be any electrical related concerns. So in the next slide, you would see that we have 24/7 contact channels which are manned to answer your calls and messages for any reports to the resumption of classes. You can reach us through our contact center at 16211, send a message through Meralco's official Facebook account, or send an SMS on the following numbers listed. Mula po sa inyong tagapaghatid ng liwanag, maraming salamat po at maasa kayo sa aming suporta. Magandang umaga po.
Maraming salamat po, Ma'am Maita C. David, mula po sa Manila Electric Company. And to our last partner agency, we have the Metropolitan Waterworks and Sewerage System, the MWSS, to be presented by the Principal Engineer C. From the Corporate Office, we have Engineer Christian A. Gonzalez.
Magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. Good morning po, Yusek Densing and Yusek Escobedo. On behalf of our Administrator, Engineer Leonor C. Cleofas, let me present the MWSS initiatives and preparations for the Oblan Balik Eskwela 2022. Next slide, please. Potable water is being supplied to the MWSS service area by our three concessionaires, Maynilad, which services Western NCR as well as parts of Cavite, Manila Water, which services the Eastern NCR, as well as some parts of the Rizal province, and Luzon Clean Water Development Corporation, which provides treated bulk water to the province of Bulacan. Next slide, please. To ensure access to safe water for drinking and hygienic purposes, 88% to 100% of customers in MWSS service areas have available water supply from 20 to 24 hours. Next slide, please. In previous years and up until now, the MWSS is a strong partner of the Department of Education in its Wash in Schools program. A total of 1,082 hand washing facilities have been installed by our partners, Maynilad and Manila Water, in public schools since 2004. This year, hand washing facilities will be installed in 160 more public schools. Next slide, please. MWSS also participated in the information, education, and communication efforts of the WINS program through Maynilad's Daloy Dunong Wash Education Training, which has engaged 134,000 students in 515 public schools in the previous years, and Manila Water's Safe Wash in Schools program through the provision of info education materials and the conduct of hygiene education sessions in participating schools. Next slide, please. In addition to our active participation in the Wash in Schools program, for the upcoming school year 2022, the MWSS shall ensure that excavations near schools are safe and passable for motorists and pedestrians. We shall also sustain intensified water quality testing. Also, we shall ensure water is available with adequate pressure in school vicinities, and we shall prioritize requests by public schools for septic tank siphoning. Next slide, please. Lastly, for your water and wastewater service concerns, you may reach us through Hotline 1626 for Maynilad and Hotline 1627 for Manila Water. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat po, Engineer Christian A. Gonzalez. Muli, nagpapasalamat po kami sa lahat ng ating partner agencies na nakasama at tuloy-tuloy na tumutulong at nagkakapit-bisig para sa ligtas na balik-aral.
At sa punto pong ito, atin pong tinatawagan ang ating mga partner agencies para po sa ating photo opportunity. Paalala lang po sa ating mga media partners po, no, na manatili po tayong nakaupo para po pagtapos ng photo opportunity ay ready na po tayo sa ating press conference.
Alam mo, partner, no, maganda tong itong katulad nating press conference and Upland Balik Eskwela kasi naririnig natin yung mga hakbang at plataporma ng iba't ibang ahensya at mga partner agencies natin dito sa DepEd, no, na talagang andun yung pagtulong nila para sa ating mga batang mag-aaral.
Tama ka dyan, partner, na talagang damang-dama natin yung suporta nung nasabi nating 17 partner agencies para masiguro na sa lahat ng aspeto ay ligtas ang ating pagbabalik eskwela. We would like to request our partner agency po sa likod para po kayo ay sama-samang makapagpa-picture. Salamat po.
Maraming salamat po muli ang ating 17 partner agencies para sa 2022 Upland Balik Eskwela. Ang buong kagawaran ng edukasyon ay nagpapasalamat sa ating mga partner agencies na nagpakita ng kanilang taus-pusong suporta para sa pagbubukas ng ating school year 2022-2023 sa August 2022.
Sa inyo pong walang sawang suporta sa DepEd, ay masisiguro po natin na magiging sapat ang pangangailangan ng ating mga teachers at learners sa pagbubukas ng ating bagong school year. At sa punto pong ito, isasagawa naman po natin ang press conference kasama sina Undersecretary and Chief of Staff Epimaco Densing III, Undersecretary Rev. C. Escobedo at DepEd Spokesperson Attorney Michael Poa kasama ang ating mga partner agencies. At upang formal pong buksan ang ating press conference ngayong araw, tawagan po natin si DepEd Spokesperson Attorney Michael Poa para po sa kanyang opening statement.
Undersecretary Densing, Undersecretary Escobedo, Honorable Undersecretaries, Assistant Secretaries, officials and heads of our partner agencies, mga media partners po natin at sa lahat po ng nanonood sa Facebook Live, magandang umaga po. Matatag, accessible, patas at dekalidad na edukasyon, yan ang isinusulong ng Department of Education di lang ngayong taon, pero sa mga taong pang darating. Naturally, it's a very hard task, kaya nga po nagpapasalamat kami sa suporta ng ating mga partner agencies today, kung saan nilahad nila ang kanilang mga commitments at kanilang mga gagawin para po tulungan tayo sa ligtas na pagbabalik-aral ng ating mga learners. Ngayong araw din po, nilulunsad natin ang ating Upland Balik Eskwela Command Center. Ang layunin po nito ay para po mapadali ang pagbibigay sa atin ng mga concerns, mga issues on the ground para po matugunan kaagad ang Department of Education. The department cannot do it alone. Even with our partner agencies, the government cannot do it alone. Kaya humingi rin po kami ng tulong sa ating mga media partners para iparating sa atin lahat ng mga encounter nyo na concerns on the ground. At humingi rin tayo ng tulong at cooperation sa mga parents para po masigurado natin or masiguro natin ang ligtas na balik-aral ng ating mga learners. They always say that it takes a village to raise a child. So let's be that village. Kapit-bisig po tayo para sa bata, para sa kinabukasan ng ating bayan. Thank you po.
Maraming salamat po, Attorney Poa. Ngayon po ay maaari na nating simulan ang ating press conference. Pero paalala lamang po sa ating media partners, hanggang 2 tanong lamang po ang ating pahihintulutan bawat reporter. Kasama na rin po dito ang ating follow-up questions dahil alam naman po natin, limited ang oras na naririto tayo ngayon. Pero kung meron po kayong iba pang katanungan, ay maaari lamang po kayong mag-leave ng message sa DepEd Philippines Facebook page.
At isa pong paalala para po direktang masagot yung ating mga katanungan, maaari nyo pong i-mention agency or kagawaran na direkta po na gusto nyong sumagot sa inyong mga katanungan. Unahin po natin mula po sa Inquirer, nandito po si Jane Bautista.
Hello. Good morning po. Jane Bautista of the Philippine Daily Inquirer. Sa DepEd po muna, regarding the shifting of classes, since mababawasan po yung oras ng pagtuturo dahil kailangan hatiin yung students, hindi po ba maapektuhan po yung quality of learning? Tapos, follow-up question po for DepEd and DPWH. Since yung paghahati po, yung shifting ng classes, yung immediate solutions natin sa overcrowding, ano po yung timetable na ina-expect natin kung kailan mapapatayo yung mga additional classrooms na kailangan ng public schools? Thank you po.
Maraming salamat sa katanungan. Doon sa issue ng shifting of classes, hindi na po ito bago. Maraming taon na po natin ginagawa ang shifting. Ang kagandahan lang nito, nag-evolution na rin. No? In fact, ang shifting natin, nung araw, umaabot ng 1:70 per shift. Lalo na dito sa Calacang, Maynila, Quezon City in particular, ngayon bumababa na to between 1:45 to 1:55 ang ratio dahil nagkaroon na po ng karagdagan ng mga silid-aralan para sa ating mga mag-aaral. Gusto ko sana banggitin na itong shifting ay nangyayari lamang dito sa Metro Manila at sa ibang mga highly urbanized city. Dahil in general po, na-meet na po ng DepEd ang standard ratio of 1:35, no? One classroom for 35 students. Nag-average na po tayo ng 1 classroom to 29 students on the average. So ang binabantayan na lang po natin itong mga lugar na matao, na matataas ang populasyon para po mabawasan po ang numero ng mga estudyante sa bawat shift. At sinisigurado naman po dati na meron talagang kalidad na edukasyon na binibigay sa ating mga mag-aaral.
Maraming salamat po, Yusek Dancing. Sunod naman po natin ay si Mr. Mark Bacalalan from DZBB.
Good evening po. Kay Tony po. Ng hawakan na COVID-19.
Maraming salamat sa katanungan. Regarding po sa mga ating guro at non-teaching personnel. Gusto ko lamang ibahagi na yung total number of teachers na unvaccinated ay maliit na bilang na lang po. Ito ay nasa 37,000. But sa 37,000 teachers, 20,000 ay nakapagpatala na magpapabakuna sila at 17,000 na lang yung hindi. At ang bago nating pulisiya ay papayagan na silang mag-report at magturo na rin provided na ay kailangan lang na they will still follow the minimum public health protocol like wearing of face mask and yung silid-aralan na kanilang pagtuturuan ay dapat maayos yung ventilation. So wala na po tayong tinatawag na kailangang bakunado o kaya hindi pahihintulutan yung mga hindi bakunado. Sa ngayon ay lahat ng teacher ay magtuturo sa ating mga estudyante at sila ay magre-report na sa kanilang mga silid-paaralan.
Pabayaran po ba sila kapag na-quarantine po yung mga teacher?
Ang magiging pulisiya po ay kung sila ay may simptomas, flu-like symptoms o hindi maganda yung kanilang karamdaman, sila ay ini-encourage na mag-stay na muna sa kanilang bahay at magpa-test. At kung sila ay nasa bahay, sila ay considered na leave o on leave o kaya excuse yung kanilang leaves.
So meaning to say, yung pagpapatest, additional burden sa teacher. Hindi kaya maging counterproductive ito, sir, dahil instead na mag-report yung mga teacher, meron silang sintomas, dahil hindi sila bayad, ay baka mamaya ay kumalat lang yung sakit kasi hindi sila bayad eh.
Sila ay, tayo naman ay nakikipag-coordinate sa Department of Health and LGUs at merong mga free test at meron tayong mga eskwelahan na kung saan ay free yung kanilang pagtetest, antigen test sa mga teachers na merong simptomas.
Thank you.
Excuse ang kanilang leave with pay.
Thank you.
Marami pong salamat, Sir Mark Bacalalan from DZBB and Yusek Escobedo. Balikan po natin yung ikalawang tanong po ni Ma'am Jane Bautista from Inquirer, referring to DPWH.
Hello. Good morning po. Yung follow-up question lang po. Since shifting of classes is the immediate solution to classroom congestion,
Ano po yung timetable na ina-expect natin kung kailan mapapatayo yung additional schools po na kailangan per public school?
Ang DPWH po, being the engineering and construction arm ng government, pag nirelease po yung pondo, i-construct po namin agad dyan within the time schedule. So, the early yung release ng pondo, the early then na makukonstruct namin, matatapos. So, that's why nag-uusap na kami ni Yusik Densing kanina, yung request ng pondo, eh, sana ma-release ng maaga at nang hindi mabawasan yung pondo. Because pag maliit ang nirelease, ilan lang yung matatapos. Pag malaki yung nirelease, marami yung matatapos. So, there is a standard contract duration for our school buildings. Kung 5 classroom, 10 classroom, 20 classroom, meron pong standard duration po tayo. So, yun po ang sinusunod natin sa construction po. So, may for a 5 classroom, meron tayong 145 days na sinusunod. For 10 classroom, may 205 calendar days. Pag 15 classroom, 240 calendar days. And 20 classroom, 4-story yun, 265 calendar days. So, yun po ang standard number of days kung ano po matapos ang mga schools po. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po, Asec Antonio V. Mulano Jr. May follow-up question po ba tayo, ma'am? So next question po ay mula naman po sa ating media partner from GMA Online. We have Giselle Ombay.
Good morning po. For DepEd po and maybe DOH, for the students part naman po, ilan na po yung mga students who are currently enrolled who have received their primary vaccine series and booster shots?
Sa ngayon po ay kinukuha pa natin yung datos kung ilang estudyante ang meron ng mga bakuna at meron na ring booster shots. So, as of today, nasa 20 million yung nakapagpatala na for this school year 2022-2023. At kaakibat nun yung report ng mga regional offices and division offices sa mga nakapagtala na ng mga estudyante, ilan doon ang may bakuna na. So, sa mga susunod na araw ay ilalabas namin yung datos kung ilan na yung may bakuna na estudyante.
Okay, sir. Follow-up question lang po. Sinabi ni OAC Verherde po, calling on students to always keep their mask on and sanitize with alcohol as social distancing in classrooms daw po will be impossible. So, is the DepEd planning to regularly provide face masks and alcohol to students for free?
Yung mga panglinis ng kamay, sabon, alcohol ay nandun po sa mga classroom. We will be providing that. In fact, we've already downloaded additional MOEs to our schools. No? However, yung sa face mask, magiging requirement na sa pagpasok ng ating mga estudyante ang pagsusot ng face mask. Pero kasama po dito, meron pong bibilihin ng mga face mask yung ating mga guro, eskwelahan, pero reserve lang po ito kung sakasakaling may nasirang face mask sa eskwelahan o may nakaiwan. So, part of the uniform, kumbaga, of the day is really the wearing of the face mask. And we will just reserve face mask in case may makalimot o may masirang face mask sa araw na yon.
Thank you, sir.
Regarding po sa question, we would like to ask po from our department, meron po tayong additional suggestions po.
None po. We'll just coordinate once we get the numbers po from our DepEd counterparts. Thank you.
Maraming salamat po. At sunod naman po natin ay from ABS-CBN, Ms. Ara Perez.
Hi po, good morning. For DOH po and DepEd, since pinapayagan po na pumasok din yung unvaccinated na students, may ilang mga school na nagsasabi na paano kaya, pwede bang sa isang classroom mga vaccinated students tapos sa kabila mga unvaccinated? Parang may ganun po silang mga pinapalutang kasi ang concern nga daw po ay yung hawaan. So ano po kaya yung masasuggest nyo na strategy para kumbaga hindi naman magkaroon ng discrimination tapos bababa din yung chances na magkaroon ng hawaan among learners and faculty na rin. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So, as katulad po ng nabanggit natin kanina, no, dalawa yung kailangan natin gawin, vaccination and minimum public health standards, continuing its practice. If we do both, the better we can protect ourselves, no, our learners and our teachers in our schools. So, kung meron po tayong mga unvaccinated, nandyan pa rin yung ibang paraan para protektahan natin yung isa't isa. Yung siguraduhin po natin na sapat yung ventilation sa ating mga classrooms. Let's open our windows, direct our fans to promote airflow, stagger lunch breaks. We can do those things. And then the wearing of face masks as necessary. So, hindi po one or the other. The more tools we have, the better are we at protecting each other. Thank you.
Additional po from the rest po regarding po doon sa question po ni Ma'am Ara. Okay po, maraming salamat po. Do we have follow-up questions po? Okay na din po. Yes, sir.
Sir, follow-up lang po regarding sa pay ng teachers. You mentioned, sir, na a paid naman kapag may leave. Pero just now, may nakausap po kami teachers na may iba na wala pang leave. So, paano po natin madedetermine yun? Kasi, di ba meron po silang special credit? Hindi naman po lahat ng teachers merong special credit dahil nakadepende rin po yun sa mga project na ginagawa po ng mga teachers. So, paano po ang gagawin kapag yung teachers na nagkaroon ng sintomas, pagkatapos wala po siyang leave na magagamit, mababayaran pa rin po ba yun?
Dahil po magbubukas tayo ng eskwelahan on August 2022, gagawin po natin, magkakaroon tayo, may ilalabas tayong department order on vaccination and yung sa safe return of our learners, teachers, and personnel sa ating mga paaralan. At meron din tayong ilalabas na department order. Tungkol naman po ito sa mga ating teachers and non-teaching personnel. Ano ang mga benepisyo o paano yung pag-file ng mga leaves kung sila ay nagkaroon ng COVID nitong school year 2022-2023. So, paantay na lang po ng DO hinggil dito.
Thank you so much po, Yusek Rev C. Escobedo. Our next question po is from the Manila Times. We have Catherine Cruz.
Hello. Hi, good. Hello, good morning po. Update lang po siguro sana kung ilan po ang ating mga public schools na mag-open ng face-to-face classes sa... Ilan po mag-open ng face-to-face classes for August 22?
Yeah, base sa ating talaan, ang expectation namin, out of the more than 47,000 public school, we expect that at least 90% will already be doing face-to-face. In the prior year, our experience is that 76% of all public schools have already had their face-to-face classes. And we expect this to rise to 90%. About 10% will be still be blended, and we will be coordinating with the local government units to ensure that they will also allow face-to-face by that time. For the private schools, I would think many of them or majority of them will still be doing blended learning at least until October 31, although some private school has already intimated their want to also do full face-to-face within the period prescribed.
So with that po, yung pagkapatayo naman po natin ng mga temporary learning spaces, kamusta na po yung process nito? And matatapos po ba ang lahat ng mga TLS natin before the start of the school year on Monday?
Sa ngayon po, nasa proseso po tayo ng pag-construct ng mga temporary learning spaces. Ito ay sa CAR and Region 1 na affected ng earthquake, Abra earthquake. Yung sa Typhoon Odette naman, meron na tayong mga naitayong mga learning spaces. At yung bilang nito ay nasa ating DRRMS na siyang may hawak ng datos. At itong mga temporary learning spaces ay nakatayo bilang pamalit doon sa mga nasirang classrooms at school buildings. Sa ABRA, magkakaroon din tayo ng hindi lang temporary learning spaces. Ito yung pagmamaximize din ng mga facilities ng ating pamahalaan. Nang sa gayon ay sa August 22 ay may magagamit ang ating mga estudyante at guro na temporary na learning spaces.
Maraming salamat po, Yusek Escobedo and Yusek Dancing. After Ms. Kathleen, we have the TV5, Ms. Marian Enriquez.
Hello. Hi, good morning po. I'm Marian Enriquez from TV5. Ibang topic po, aside from Upland Balik Eskwela. Update lang po sana sa COA report regarding po dito sa issue sa laptop. Sir, I understand na we are still requesting for some documentary requirements para maisagot po natin sa COA regarding to sa AOM. But how are we looking into this within our department? Like, what was the explanation po of the office that handled this transaction with PSDBM? Paano raw po nila hinayaan na lumusot or tanggapin nga itong mga laptop na pricey yet outdated laptops? Ano raw po yung sagot? Paano lumusot ito? And comment lang po sa papatawag din ang DepEd sa Senate probe na nilaunch, gusto nga po i-launch nila Senator Kiko.
Siguro ilagay natin sa tamang perspective, ano? Merong inalabas na AOM or Audit Observation Memorandum ang COA mula pa nung Marso. Limang item po ito, no? Dun sa limang item, yung isang item po doon nasagot natin at yung apat na item hindi natin nasagot dahil mula ito yung mga dokumento kailangan manggaling sa PSDBM. So dahil hindi po nasagot yung apat, minarapat po ng COA na ilagay na talaga ito officially sa website ng COA. Kaya nga nakita natin ng COA na mayroong AOM doon ang DepEd, no? At kaming mga bagong opisyales, pagkalabas po nito, una naming tiningnan ay kung bakit hindi nasagot yung apat na audit observation memorandum ng COA. So kami po ay nakipag-meeting sa COA. Ako mismo ang nakipag-meeting sa COA kasama po yung isa naming Undersecretary for Finance. At ang COA po ay nagbigay ng 28 items or documents na kailangan namin ibigay sa kanila. So kami po ay sumulat sa PSDBM kay Mr. Dennis Santiago. At pagkaraan po ng pagsulat namin, ibinigay niya kaagad ang 28 dokumento na hinihingi ng COA na manggagaling sa PSDBM. And we've transmitted these 28 documents to COA immediately. And the recent update is that since most of the information is beyond us, considering that these are PSDBM transactions and considering that these were transactions done by previous officials, the Vice President and Secretary Sara Duterte has already permitted us or to write a letter to Attorney Jose Calida, Chairperson of the Commission on Audit, to ask him for a fraud audit from COA. And we've officially transmitted that letter today. So that's the latest, and hopefully later on there will be some updates, and our spokesperson, Attorney Mike Poe, will be able to give that updates in mga susunod nilang mga press con. Yun pong latest.
Sir, may we ask just some specifics lang po, like anong office po yung nag-handle sa atin sa DepEd sa pakikipag-transact po sa PSDBM itong pricey yet outdated laptops, and what was their explanation po sa atin based on our, I guess, maybe meetings with them?
Ang una sa lahat, ang perang ito ay hindi kasama sa regular na budget ng DepEd ng 2021. No? This is a budget, this 2.4 billion came from the Bayanihan to Recover Act as one, which is the Bayanihan 2 law, no? Republic Act 11494. So because of that budget, hindi kinaya po o hindi kakayanin ng DepEd at that time, at base sa mga kwento, na ito'y ma-acquire or ma-procure. Kaya nga binabuti po ng DepEd at that time para rin po mahabol ang deadline, kundi isusoli po ito, ay inarapat na dalhin sa PSDBM because they have the expertise. And more or less, this is also the reason why we are paying PSDBM. We're paying 3% of the total cost of the procurement. Kasi hinihingi natin kanilang serbisyo ng pakapag-procure. So, dapat maayos na ipoprocure ito ng PSDBM at least at that time. So, ngayon, dahil ina-assume namin na dahil sila po ang eksperto sa pagpoprocure ng ganitong klaseng mga materyales o mga laptops na kinakailangan ng DepEd, kailangan malinis din ang kanilang dokumentasyon dito. So there's an assumption or assumption of regularity on the part of PSDBM that all processes of procurement have been passed through and complied with, no? Kami sa labas ang DepEd nasa labas kami para lang masigurado na may meet din nila ang deadline. Although a number of our personnel from DepEd is also there in the technical working group to ensure that whatever the requirements are also complied with. Ngayon, while hindi namin madedeklara kaagad as of today na nagkaroon ng anomalya ba dyan, hindi natin masasagot kaagad yan hanggat ito'y masagot ng PSDBM. Kasi ang isa sa pinaka-importanting proseso ng pag-procure ay yung tinatawag nating market scanning. Ang ibig sabihin po nito, pag nagpo-procure ka, bago bumili, kailangan po ang ahensya, in this case PSDBM, kailangan nagtatanong sa merkado kung magkano ba itong laptop na ito na ganito ang spesifikasyon. At nung bumalik po sila sa technical working group, inilabas itong presyo na 58,000. At ang ibinabantayan po natin ngayon at tinitingnan po namin, it's not an official investigation yet, and this is the reason why we are asking COA to do a fraud audit, is the reason why it was downgraded from 1.9 gigahertz to 1.8 gigahertz, and at the same time, tumaas din yung presyo. And why is it Intel Celeron? Because we were very specific in the specifications of the laptop. So itong mga areyang ito ang gusto naming iklaro, gusto naming tingnan, at ayaw namin maghusga muna ngayon. Dahil alam nyo, maski sa presyo ng ating mga binibili, nag-iiba yan from time to time, nag-iiba based on the demands. So in the meantime, while we are not declaring that there is a fraudulent transaction that happened at that time, we are also not saying that there is none. In fact, sa totoo lang, kaming mga nandito ngayon, nung nalaman po namin yan, nakakaramdam din kami ng galit kung sakaling totoo yan. At ayaw namin itong mangyari. Kaya nga po, dikta po sa amin o direktiba po ni Secretary Sara, ni VP Sara, paimbestigahan nyo na yan para makita kung merong bang kalokohan o wala.
Last na lang po, second question ko po would be, since I understand po na based po dun sa DO34, yung physical distancing po, whenever possible lang, no, pwede ma-implement. So how are we preparing our classrooms, our schools, para ma-improve po yung ventilation? Kasi syempre, marami nga po, siksika na yung mga bata. Paano po ba yung gagawin natin dun? And also sa mga private schools na I guess naka-aircon, hindi na ba papagamitin muna ng aircon? Paano po natin naayusin yung ventilation?
Tama po kayo, sa DO 34 nakalagay po doon yung physical distancing whenever possible. Sa ngayon po, ang ginagawa natin, nagkakaroon tayo ng class programming. Kapag ang isang klase ay 30 or 35 at well ventilated yung isang classroom at medyo maluwag naman yun distance ng mga estudyante ay full size silang papasok. Doon sa 68 or 50 na students, yan po ang pinag-aaralan ngayon ng ating mga regional directors dahil po pre-pandemic ay talagang siksikan yung ating mga estudyante. At ang karamihan nga dyan, for example, in Cavite, may isang section doon na hindi na talaga kayang i-accommodate kasi kulang din ng silya. Sa ngayon, kung kakayanin ay i-accommodate lahat ng mga estudyante at sisiguruhin na lang na ang mga estudyante na papasok sa eskwela ay naka-face mask at maayos yung ventilasyon ng silid paaralan. Meaning, bukas yung mga bintana, bukas yung mga pinto at yung ceiling fan ay dapat gumagana at ito ay may maayos na ventilation sa loob ng silid paaralan.
Thank you po. Once again, Yusek Densing for the clarifications. Also, we have questions from GMA7. We have Ian Cruz.
Yusek Densing, Attorney Poa. Yusek Densing, you mentioned kanina na pinapaimbisigahan ni VP Sara itong nangyari dun sa laptop. Kailan po ba niya, can you just elaborate, kailan po niyo nakausap si Vice President para sabihin po na kailangang idulog na sa COA itong fraud audit?
Well, mula nung lumabas yung AOM, mataga sinimula na namin ang pag-uusap nito, pero nung Biyernes lamang po, binigyan kami ng clearance direktiba ni Vice President and Secretary Sara Duterte na magpadala na ng fraud audit request sa COA. So, nung yung Biyernes, napirma na po ito, na-receive na ng aming resident COA, pero yung sulat mismo na address kay Chairperson Jose Calida ay on the way na today.
Definitely, sir, ayaw ni VP Sara na magkaroon pa kayo ng another procurement with the PSDBM. Gusto po ba niya na lahat ng procurement in the future ng DepEd ay DepEd na ang directly mag-handle po para makaiwas sa ganito mga controversy?
Well, mula pa banin noon na matagal na hindi na nagpo-procure masyado ang DepEd sa PSDBM. Nagkataon lang na itong budget na ito, itong 2.4 billion na hindi mismo nanggagaling sa regular na budget ng DepEd for 2021. Kaya dahil sa kakulangan ng panahon at para ma-procure din ang mga laptop nito, nagkaroon ng desisyon noon na ipadaan ito sa PSDBM. Pero more or less kami sa Execom ng DepEd, we are already one that for future procurement, we will do our procurement via our own procurement service here at the DepEd. At hopefully, wala nang ganong klase mga budget na ibibigay out of the blue para hindi na rin tayo dumaan sa PSDBM.
Na-mention po kanina ni Yusek Escobedo na 37,000 pa sa mga teachers ang unvaccinated. Ina-ascertain pa natin yung bilang naman sa mga estudyante. Pero pag umiikot po kami sa mga schools, most of them sinasabing 75% to 80% yung mga vaccinated na mga students. And majority sa kanila hindi nagpapabakuna dahil sa vaccine hesitancy ng kanilang guardians or parents. So paano po natin i-address ito, itong vaccine hesitancy, para po mas marami pang mga estudyante po ang mabakunahan?
Kung titingnan po natin ang Department Order 34, magkakaroon tayo ng tinatawag na vaccination counseling. In fact, nakikipag-ugnayan na kami sa Department of Health. Ang kausap ko po dito, si ASIC Beverly Hall, ho, na magkakaroon kami ng joint memorandum circular sa ating mga eskwelahan na patuloy po tayo magkakaroon ng counseling sa ating mga parents na makumbinsi natin sila na pabakunahan ang kanilang mga anak at sila na rin bilang mga magulang kung hindi pa sila bakunado. At kung makakuha tayo ng maayos na numerong mga bata na magpapabakuna, doon po tayo maglalagay na tinatawag nating vaccination sites. So the vaccination sites will only be there after we've already gathered a number of students, parents, or even teaching and non-teaching personnel who have already would want to be vaccinated. So ganun po ang magiging kalakaran natin para makumbinsi po natin ang mga magulang na papakunahan po yung kanilang mga anak.
Sir, panghuli na lang po sa end ko. Itong atin pong command center, paano po gagana to? May hotline po ba at saka Facebook page or any other social media page na pwedeng makontak po ng ating mga kababayan para po makapag-impart sila ng any complaint or any concern?
Yes po, no? Yung command center natin, marami po kaming hotlines. We also have mobile phones, landlines, and then we also have emails and the Facebook page. Ipapa-flash ko na lang po sa screen. Siguro mas maganda, meron naman po tayong media group. Ipapalagay ko na rin po ito sa media group para hindi na kailangan kopyahin ngayon. So you can also help us disseminate the information.
Maraming salamat po, Yusik Dancing, Attorney Poa, and Sir Ian Cruz. And lastly, we have from Daily Tribune.
Hello po. Neil Alcover from Daily Tribune. Ano po yung plans ng DepEd kung patuloy pa rin po tataas yung COVID cases by November? Tuloy pa rin po ba yung face-to-face classes?
Well, sa ngayon, ayon po sa DepEd Order No. 34 na rin, no, regardless of alert levels, tuloy-tuloy po tayo sa ating classes. Ngayon, also, I think we received information from the DOH na halos nagpipeak na yung cases natin sa Metro Manila. But as to yung pagpatuloy ng pagtaas ng cases sa November, we will just have to monitor the situation and react accordingly po.
Another question po. Kung limited po yung number of students per room, hindi ba kulang yung classrooms?
Oo. Kaya nga po tayo mayroong class programming para una, ma-address yung kakulangan ng classroom. For example, kung sa isang paaralan ay nagkukulang sila ng tatlo o hanggang limang classroom, magkakaroon ng adjustment. Magkakaroon ng class programming. Ibig sabihin, may morning shift at afternoon shift. Nang sa gayon, ang mga estudyante ay magkaroon ng learning spaces sa loob ng classroom. At yun yung ginagawa at ng ating mga regional directors at schools division superintendents bilang paghahanda para sa nalalapit na pagbubukas ng ating klase.
Maraming salamat po.
And we also have the last 5 questions po. And this will be coming from the ABS-CBN. We have Joyce Balancio.
Thank you. Apo, follow-up lang po dun sa ONCOA. Kay Yusik Dancing, you've mentioned earlier that Vice President Duterte has asked for a fraud audit from COA. Ano pong timeline nito, Yusik? As kailan natin in-expect we will receive the audit report? Yun muna po. And what's the worst that can happen if in case meron nga pong fraud, especially if there are still, I don't know, if there are still some DepEd officials from the previous administration who are still with the current administration? Thank you.
Well, kung gaano katagal ang fraud audit, hindi namin masasagot yan kasi may sariling proseso po ang COA kung gaano ito katagal. No? Pangalawa, worst case scenario, may nakita po silang hindi tama, lalabas naman po ito sa report at syempre, yung mga tamang ahensya ng gobyerno po ay magpa-file ng kaso. But of course, we will give due process to everybody in this case.
Reaction din po, may statement po na finorward sa ABS-CBN News, yung joint venture, at least 2 of the companies involved, or yung nagawaran po ng contracts for the laptops, and they said that nanindigan po sila na sumunod po sila sa request ng DepEd in terms of specifications, and yung price daw po na 58,000, that includes yung software's warranty, etc., etc. Reaction lang po sa statement nila.
De, siguro hayaan na po natin ang COA mag-determine yan at saka inuulit namin, ayaw namin magbigay ng komento dyan dahil ito po'y transaction na ginawa ng PSDBM. So sila po ang gumawa ng market scanning at of course ang role ng DepEd ay kami nagbigay ng specification. So kung anong nangyaring pagkakaiba in between, hayaan po natin na tingnan po yan ng COA. So antayin na lang po natin.
Last na lang po for me. On dengue, naghihintay po kanina ng any update. Meron po ba specific protocols ang ilalabas ang DepEd for the dengue prevention sa schools and also if the DOH representative can also comment on how to prevent this? Thank you.
Sige. Ma'am, from DOH's end po, no, you will still continue to do our preventive practices. Yung paglilinis natin ng mga stagnant na lalagyan, ng pag-ipunan ng tubig, cleanliness, and then our hygiene practices. So, alam na po ng ating mga LGU, ng mga guro sa ating mga paaralan, pati ng mga kasamahan nating barangay health workers sa community ito. Tapos sinasagawa naman po nila ito regularly. So ipapagpatuloy lang po natin ito, lalo na ngayon babalik na po sa paaralan ng mga kabataan.
Maraming salamat po. And for the last question, coming from Manila Bulletin, we have Ms. Ina Hernando.
Good day, everyone. For DepEd po, sir, clarification lang on the number of schools na mag-implement ng face-to-face. While Yusek Densing mentioned that you're expecting around 90% of the 47,000 schools will implement. Pero kasi po ngayon, as we go around the schools, most of them, wala pa po silang desisyon kung anong learning modality yung gagamitin nila, which also causes anxiety sa parents because hindi pa nakakapag-decide yung school kung ano po yung learning modality na gagamitin. So meron po ba tayong like deadline sa mga regional offices natin kung kailan nila maisasubmit, at least man lang initial numbers, kung ano-ano yung mga schools na mag-face-to-face, mag-blended, or mag-full distance learning this ano during the transition period.
Under DO 34, tatlo po yung modality for mula August 22 to bago mag November 2. Ito yung face-to-face, blended learning, at full distance learning. Sa ngayon po ay nagsasubmit na yung mga regional offices at mga division offices ng mga schools, lalo na yung mga public schools na mag-o-open. Ibig sabihin, bukas na sila sa in-person classes. Yung nag-aapila, karamihan, ay yung mga private schools. Kasi nga, last school year pa, ay nag-offer na sila kung ano magiging modality nila for this school year 2022-2023. At may iilan sa kanila na naka-program for blended learning, at may iilan din na naka-program for distance learning. Ang amin namang tugon ay patuloy kaming nakikipag-usap sa mga private schools kung paano yung transition from blended learning or full distance learning to face-to-face classes or in-person classes. Nang sa gayon, by November 2 ay tuluyan na tayong makapag balik ng ligtas sa ating mga eskwelahan.
There another question, clarification lang on the no uniform policy, because it was announced earlier na hindi po required ang uniforms. Pero sa school po kasi, when you ask the officials and even the LGUs, they prefer that their students wear uniforms for the safety. And of course, yung ma-identify easily yung mga estudyante. So clarification lang, sir, for the parents who feel and who insist na hindi required ang uniforms pagpasok sa paaralan.
Well, uulitin lang natin yung department order noong 2010 ano, on this, and the pronouncement of the Vice President Secretary Sara Duterte that there will be, we will be invoking that department order of the no schools uniform requirement. Mayroon na nagtanong yan over the weekend ng mga local government officials na gustong magbigay nga ng uniforme. Pwede po naman magbigay ng uniforme, pero ang gusto lang natin sabihin, in case yung bata hindi makakuha, hindi makapagsuot ng uniforme, no sanctions will be given to the learner. Hindi rin siya, bibigyan pa rin siyang pagkakataong pumasok sa klase. Yun lang po ang ibig sabihin nun, no? So, hindi siya magiging major impediment on the part of the learner for the learner to go inside the classroom and then study. Yun lang po ang ibig sabihin po.
Paano po, sir, pag yung school mismo ang nagsiset ng dress code? So like, for example, they say na hindi pwede ang shorts or whatsoever na isusuot. What if the schools themselves, sila po yung magsabi na hindi kayo pwedeng pumasok ng ito yung inyong suot?
Hindi po pwedeng gawin ng school yan dahil malinaw po ang direktiba ng pinakamataas na opisyalis ng DepEd na hindi kailangan mag-require. Ang, of course, ang pakiusap lang natin, kung kaya lang naman po ng ating mga magulang na at least pumasok yung ating mga estudyante ng maayos po yung kanyang kasuotan. Yun lang po ang pakiusap. Kung hindi naman talaga kaya, dahil sa kahirapan din ng ating mga kababayan, din hindi rin po sila dapat kumbaga i-prohibit na pumasok at mag-aral. So yun po ang general rule.
Last na lang from the ICT representative, sir. Meron po kasing statement ng Alliance of Concerned Teachers urging that the ICT to distribute na lang po yung mga unused laptops, at least 800 of them, and at least 12,000 gadgets na sinabi po ng COA na hindi ginagamit ng DICT to our learners and teachers na kailangan po ng gadget. Statement.
Thank you for that question. So right now we're coordinating with COA. That is an AOMG findings. So just to put context into it, that's an AOMG findings. At may tatlong findings doon. Ang madalas lang na nakukote is yung pangatlo, which is unused. Responded to the COA AOMG. June 2022 lang po ito lumabas. Ah. So we responded already by June 24, 2022. And we are just awaiting for COA's response also to our response to their audit observation memorandum. So pag na-clear na yan, happy to distribute them. For the record, schools. So basta we're just waiting for...
Thank you so much po, ASEC. Jeffrey, Ian, CD for answering our last question. And I believe that includes our press conference for today. Thank you so much po sa mga media partners na nakasama natin ngayong umaga. Maraming salamat po at ingat po tayong lahat.
Muli, pinasasalamatan po natin lahat ng dumalo sa ating programa, sa ating DepEd officials, partner agencies, at sa ating mga media partners.
Maraming salamat po sa inyong walang sawang suporta sa kagawaran ng edukasyon para sa ating paghahanda sa pagbubukas ng ating klase sa August 22.
Paalala lamang po, of course, sabi nga ni, di ba, partner, na August 2022 na, fast approaching na, no? Kaya paalala lamang po sa ating mga magulang na ipa-enroll na po natin ang ating mga anak sa ating paaralan, dahil sinisiguro ng DepEd or Department of Education na safe and secured ang ating pagbabalik-aral.
Gayun din, maaari nyo naman pong tawagan ang mga numero na inyo pong nakikita sa ating screen para sa inyong mga concerns, issues, and suggestions patungkol po sa enrollment at sa ating paghahanda sa bagong school year.
Yes, at nakahanda rin po ang ating Public Assistance Command Center para sagutin ang inyong mga hinaing. Bukod sa mga numero na nakikita nyo po sa ating screen, maaari nyo rin pong ipahatid ang inyong concern sa ating email, action@deped.gov.ph, o maaari po kayong mag-iwan ng mensahe sa DepEd Philippines Facebook page.
Panibagong taon na naman itong muli para sa ating... para ating na balik-aral. Para sa bata,
para sa bayan,
magandang araw po.